Well, I think actually there are some basic principles to how human thinking works. My last book, How to Create a Mind, which came out in 2012, which resulted in me being recruited to Google to try to practice those ideas, talks about how the human neocortex works. It's an outgrowth of a thesis that I had had for actually 50 years, because I wrote a paper when I was 14 and 15, 1962, and won a science contest, the Westinghouse Science Talent Search. Now the Intel Science Talent Search, got to meet President Johnson, and I described human thinking as consisting of modules of neurons. Each module can recognize a pattern, and the basis of human thinking is pattern recognition. And those patterns are actually sequential, and they're in one direction. And I gave a lot of evidence for this. For example, try to recite the alphabet. Most of you can do that. If I ask you, well, recite it backwards, you probably can't do that unless you learn that as a new sequence. It's a pretty trivial transformation, and yet we can't do it. So we have different hints as to how the human brain works. In recent years, there's been an explosion of neuroscience evidence. For example, the European Brain Reverse Engineering Project has identified modules of about 100 neurons each. And since the neocortex has 30 billion neurons, that means 300 million modules. And they all are pretty much the same. They have the same structure, the same organization within them. And there's no plasticity, no change within that module for your entire life, despite the idea that your brain's constantly rewiring itself. There is plasticity, constant rewiring between the modules, and each module is recognizing a pattern. We can see the axons coming in from other modules that are feeding the sequential input that represents the pattern that this module will learn. So it's a hierarchy of patterns. This pattern is based on a hierarchy of patterns in the modules below it, and each one of those has input from modules below it, and it's a very elaborate hierarchy. And biological evolution evolved this hierarchical structure in the brain so that it could understand and learn the hierarchical structure of the world, because the world is organized hierarchically. The neocortex emerged 200 million years ago in mammals. Only mammals have a neocortex, and it was a thin structure. Neocortex means new rind, and it was about this in these first mammals, which were rodents. It was about the size of a postage stamp and just as thin as a postage stamp, and it wrapped around the walnut-sized brains of these early mammals. But it was capable of a new type of thinking. It could invent new behaviors. Non-mammalian animals, like reptiles that didn't have a neocortex, couldn't do that. They had fixed behaviors. It didn't help them that much, actually, because the environment changed very slowly and could take 50,000 years for there to be an environmental change that would require a new behavior. And over that 50,000 years, these non-mammalian animals could evolve, using normal Darwinian evolution, a new fixed behavior. But then something happened 65 million years ago. There was a sudden catastrophic change to the environment. We call it the Cretaceous extinction event. And that's when mammals overtook their ecological niche. That's when the neocortex actually showed its capability. And biological evolution then grew it. Mammals now, instead of being just little rodents, got bigger. Their brains got bigger at an even faster pace, taking up a larger fraction of their body. And the neocortex got bigger even faster than that and developed these curvatures and folds. If you look at a primate brain, it's got this characteristic curvatures. So it now takes up 80% of the brain. Then something else happened 2 million years ago. If you remember, 2 million years ago, we were walking around. We didn't have these big foreheads. So humanoids came along with a big forehead. And that houses the frontal cortex. And up until recently, it was thought, well, the frontal cortex does such qualitatively different things, it must be organized differently. It must have a different method, a different algorithm. I make the case, and I think the neuroscience is coming around to this view, it really was just an additional quantity of neocortex. Well, so what did we do with that additional quantity? Well, we were already doing a very good job of being primates. So we put it at the top of the neocortical hierarchy. So this hierarchy, which I mentioned, now got bigger. As you go up the hierarchy, things get more general, more intelligent, more abstract. At the very bottom, I can tell that that's a straight line. At the top, I can tell that, oh, that's funny, that's ironic, she's pretty. So that additional hierarchy that we got 2 million years ago was the enabling factor for us to invent language and art and science and music. Every human culture we've ever discovered has music. No primate or any other animal has music. That came from this additional neocortex. And I make the case in my book, How to Create a Mind, what the algorithm is of each of these modules. They all have the same algorithm. So people, a lot of people like to say, oh, the brain is so complex, it's the most complex thing in the universe. That may be true, but it has a regular repeating structure. Each of these 300 million modules is basically the same. Now, they self-organize into these hierarchies, and each module discovers a pattern and learns it and remembers it and can recognize it even in a different context, so it's very good at metaphor. And I describe my thesis on how this works. As we continue doing more and more brain reverse engineering, we will refine that model, but I've been working with this model, and we find that it can, in fact, master things like language, not yet at human levels, but doing still some impressive things. We've moved beyond, for example, things like Jeopardy, which itself was pretty sophisticated. So there is kind of a master algorithm, at least I have a proposal for one. These deep neural nets, which there's tremendous excitement about, which is a little bit different than the model I have, but they've done remarkable things. I mean, they won the Go championship, and they can recognize images, as I mentioned, better than humans, and can drive cars. And that's actually pretty simple. I mean, you can read about deep neural nets. The algorithm is, again, a repeating structure that's not that complicated. So the mathematics of thinking, I think, is being understood. I would not claim that we understand it fully, but we're getting more and more hints as we learn more and more about the human brain.